five, four, three, two, one, zero.
Gentlemen, welcome in to a special edition of the Smoke Break. So glad to have you on this one, and I hope I find you well. As you've seen over the last several weeks, I've had a bunch of players come on, as have other members of the Buffalo Fanatics community. It's been a lot of fun keeping the offseason entertaining, and that's the goal. But I have yet to be as excited for an interview as I am for this one. Not often do I get to have somebody on the show who has 13 Emmy Awards. And no, they do not wear a Buffalo Bills uniform, but they do a lot of work behind the scenes. And that's the stuff that often goes unseen, but is the most crucial. And I'm so excited to welcome on Michelle Girardi Zumwalt from Pegula Sports Entertainment. Here she is, Michelle. Thank you so much for joining the show. I couldn't be more excited to have you on.
Don't like pump me up too much. You know, you're going to make me nervous.
No, you're nervous. Are you kidding me? I'm the one who's nervous to even have you on with your track record. Incredible stuff. So right off the bat, Michelle, like I had just told everybody, 13 Emmys. And I don't think I've ever met anybody who has won, let alone 13 times that amount. For people who may not know Michelle, you definitely know the work that she has done throughout her career. Michelle spent over a decade with NFL Films, and then she has been with Pegula Sports and Entertainment for the last 6 years, most recently as the supervising producer, which is about as big as it gets over in that realm. And Michelle oversees Buffalo Bills Embedded. You have, of course, have seen that. But where I want to start is what I'm sure you would probably say is your most rewarding or probably one of your most favorite projects that you've worked on to date. The ESPN 30 for 30, Four Falls of Buffalo. Michelle was a producer for the film that I know everyone watching, including myself, had a few tears coming down their face at one point or another throughout that amazing film. 30 for 30s, Michelle, have always been, they're amazing. Ever since the first one came out, I was hooked. And when it came out that, you know, the Bills were going to get their own, the initial thought was, wow, of course the Bills are getting a movie based on what everybody uses as the punchline for the Buffalo Bills. But the movie, it did exactly what I hoped it would do. And that was take that punchline and really show what those four Super Bowls meant to the city of Buffalo and the organization. It wasn't about losing the games. It's about all it took to go into it, the coaching staff, the players, and the emotions that it brought out in so many people within the Buffalo Bills community. Being a Buffalo native, let's start there. Just your overall thoughts working on that project and how much it meant to you being from Buffalo, growing up in that era and watching it firsthand, then portraying it in the documentary.
Yeah, I mean, I was just honored to be asked to be a part of it. So Ken Rogers, who directed it, he directed the two Bills and several other really popular 30 for 30s, you know, approached me and was like, we have to have you on this project. You know, you lived this experience. You love Buffalo. We know that you'll give it sort of that that love and care that it needs so that Bills fans can actually dive into it and appreciate it. And he came to it initially with, you know, he didn't want it to be, like you said, a punchline or a joke about losing the Super Bowls. He wanted to get into how hard it is to like pick yourself off the ground and go back and do it again, and how, you know, the Bills were a punchline, but should they be? Because, you know, yeah, they didn't win the big game, but they went back 4 years in a row. And they, you know, if you're an Olympic athlete and you win a silver medal, you can still travel around the country and show everybody your silver medal. But when you lose the Super Bowl, it's like, oh, you're the worst team. You're a joke. But no, you were up there, right up there with the best the whole time. Should you be a laughingstock, or should you be remembered as a really, really good team that, yeah, didn't get it done, but was still spectacular?
And it's funny you mention that because it oftentimes, almost all the time, goes overlooked. There's a reason it hasn't happened again. There's a reason it probably will never happen again. It's because it's that difficult. Many would argue it's even more difficult to lose all four in a row, but the movie itself encapsulated all those different angles. And for somebody like me who wasn't even alive during that era, but the reason I'm a Bills fan is because of my dad. Knowing everything that had happened during the late 90s, but not being alive for it, all I know of it is the, you know, the encounters my dad had told to me. Sitting down and being able to live that with him as he relived it, and I basically lived it for the first time, was, I'll never forget watching it for the first time, truthfully. My dad would continuously bring up different tidbits as he recalled it. And then I just kind of sat in and soaked in what everybody had gone through within the Buffalo Bills fan base at that time. Did you realize as you were making it that that was going to be a big part of the documentary, knowing that a lot of the fan base, you know, in their 20s or late teens would be seeing a lot of this stuff for the first time? Yes, they knew well about it. And of course, if you're a Bills fan, you're linked to the four Super Bowl losses. But a lot of those younger fans, they really have no connection to that at all.
Yeah, I mean, we thought a lot about that. And for myself, I was born in 1982. So I was a kid during that Super Bowl run. Obviously, I remember it, but there's a lot of things that you forget as well. So I actually sat in the Channel 7 studios at one point, going through their archives, just putting in tape after tape after tape, watching old, you know, news reports about the games and watching Irv Weinstein and, you know, seeing the commercials from the early 90s. So it was a real nostalgia trip for me too, to like kind of relive that era and think about, you know, the electricity in the city at that time. You know, my neighborhood, we would always get together at somebody else's house, you know, every Sunday for the games, and you'd see grown men like my dad and my neighbors and his friends like dogpiling on each other in the living room, so excited and like yelling and screaming. And you just kind of always thought that that was how it was going to be. So it was really cool to relive it again, and also emotional. I remember, you know, Super Bowl 25, like I was, you know, a kid during that. I was like 8 years old, you know, rewatching that fourth quarter for the first time as an adult. I was sitting in Ken Rogers' office on the couch and he put it on and I was like sweating. I was so nervous. Like I was basically nauseous, thinking about knowing how it was going to end and how that like wide right has haunted all of us, whether you watched it or you weren't even born for it. You know, wide right, you have a visceral reaction to it. And it was emotional to watch it and to go through it again.
You know, it's the most cliche thing a non-Bills fan can say to a Bills fan when you're in any argument about sports, and it's at least we didn't lose four Super Bowls. I wasn't alive for it, so I don't attach myself to it. But having that experience and watching it, I was able to truly understand what it was like to go through that. And I was sitting next to the guy who did go through that, the reason I'm a Bills fan. So the emotions, like you said, it was impossible to not be emotional. The part of the movie, though, that expressed that emotion more than any other angle, of course, Scott Norwood. And to me, it's the one thing that I always think of when I think of the four Super Bowl losses. I think that's what the majority of people think. It's wide right. What I never knew, and I'm assuming many people didn't either, the outpour of love given to Scott Norwood in his darkest hours. And it was that point of the movie where you realize it didn't matter win or lose. The Bills fan base is unlike any other, and they will welcome you in with open arms no matter what. You had the privilege of conducting that interview, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
Correct.
What? Take me into the room. You're with Scott Norwood. I can't imagine he talks about that moment often, let alone in front of a camera. You relive it with him. What was that like?
Yeah, he, I think, had not done an interview for over a decade. I think he did one for Sports Illustrated in the early 2000s. So this, and he, you're absolutely right. He rarely talks about it. He doesn't want to relive it. I mean, why would you? So I actually got to him through, we had been contacting or attempting to contact Scott, and nobody, you know, we hadn't gotten a call back, hadn't heard anything. We were able to interview Bruce DeHaven when he was the special teams coach for the Panthers. And he loved our interview so much and was so excited about the project that he volunteered to call Scott for me. And he was like, you know, I'll give him your number and he'll call you back if, you know, or, Wait, hang on, let me remember that. No, he said, I'll ask him if it's okay to give you his number and then we'll see if he calls you back. So anyway, he gives Scott my number. And Scott, I keep screwing this up. I'm sorry.
Watch or recall. You've done so much.
It was a while ago at this point. Now I'm like, all right. So he gives me Scott's number. I call him before Thanksgiving and I'm like, you know, leave him a message, get the voicemail. I call him once, you know, 3 weeks later. And then at this point, it's January. I get the call back and I'm actually at home with my two little kids at the time I get the call. And I'm like, oh my God, I think this is Scott. So I'm running around my house. My kids are chasing me because we had like a bad connection and I didn't want to lose it. And I was waiting for him to call me and, you know, finally got him. And he's like sort of a low talker. So I'm like trying to hear him. And he was like, okay, you know, Bruce really, you know, spoke really highly of you. I think that, you know, we can do this. So let's set it up. And we got the interview booked. And I was so nervous because he was, I always described him as sort of like the Kaiser Soze of my childhood. He's like this villain out there that's like a shadowy figure. And, you know, if he'd made that kick, we would have won the Super Bowl. And you know, he was the punchline, right? He's the one that everybody makes fun of. And he's not a person to a lot of people. He's just wide right to people. So it was crazy to talk to him and then to go and meet him. And it was again, emotional. It was, you feel so bad for the guy, right? And, you know, but that's not necessarily how he defines his life either. Like he was very clear about that. He's like, I'm not, people think that I'm, you know, holding on to this and it's ruined me. He's like, but I don't think about it. You know, I have my wife and my kids and a life beyond football and it hasn't destroyed me. And so it was interesting. It was sort of like, you know, you could see why he doesn't want to talk about it because if you were him, would you want that to be the one thing that you're, you know, constantly known for? So it was a long interview. It was 3 hours of the first time we spoke to him. And then we met him again at City Hall on the steps where the parade had taken place after the Super Bowls and, you know, got him to sit down with Bruce DeHaven. So, yeah, it was crazy. And he became a friend and we started texting and I was like, what is my life that now I like text jokes to Scott Norwood and, you know, just have like funny offhanded conversations with him. It's been very cool. And it's great that I've been able to kind of in my own life, like let that go, because I think all of us hold on to that wide right, you know, all of us Bills fans and, you know, it's over for me now. It's like, you're able to kind of get closure from it and move on.
That was the most impactful part of the film was watching him speak to the crowd and, you know, the people who took their kids out of school to go to the parade and celebrate the team, despite losing in such a heartbreaking fashion, to watch him address the crowd and you would have thought the Bills won the Super Bowl the way that they were cheering on Scott. That to me, it stood with me and it always will, because I frankly did not know that that was the reality of the situation afterwards. And I think personally, I just believed that he was kind of outcasted by the Bills fan base, but it was anything but, and you guys portrayed that beautifully. Was there a part of the filmmaking process where you wondered if Scott Norwood was not going to be a part of it since it was so tough to get a hold of him?
Yeah. And I will add too, one thing that I learned was that our parade was bigger than the Giants victory parade. They had like 5,000 people come out or something in the biggest market in the country, one of the biggest cities in the world. And yeah, we had 25,000 show up.
No shock.
Niagara Square. Yeah. I mean, that was the whole thing was we weren't sure. He hadn't done interviews. We didn't think we were going to get him. And I think that's also part of the reason why Ken Rogers really wanted me on the film, because he knew that the players could talk to me and relate to me and know that I understood and that I wasn't trying to make them look bad. You know, I wanted people to realize how great these teams were, how great these guys are, and how awesome Buffalo is. Like you said, we wanted to show people like, you know, you might make fun of Bills fans, but they always come through, you know, for their team and for each other, this whole community. You know, I think we've proven that a lot in the last several years too, you know, how tight knit this place is and how we're always willing to help people out and lift people up. So yeah, that was really important to me. And I think that, you know, guys like Bruce DeHaven and Scott Norwood and eventually everyone else realized that that was the mission of the film and made them a lot more comfortable participating.
In your opinion, what would the film have been had that portion of it not been in? Because it took the documentary to a whole other level.
Yeah. I mean, I have to agree with that. Everybody talks about getting Norwood making the entire documentary. I don't know. I can't even think about it because right, as soon as we knew we had him, it was like, yes, this is it now. Like this is a film to watch because nobody else has this. So yeah, without Scott, I don't think it's nearly as popular as it is. A lot of people listed among, you know, maybe top 50 or top 25, 30 for 30s, which is an honor.
Did you have any say in the decision to put in the edit where Scott makes the field goal?
So that's actually an old edit that we put in a film in the late 90s where we had interviewed Tim Russert. They did that sort of like fake, you know, Van Miller radio call and edit for that. And Ken Rogers told me at the beginning that was his vision, was that the film begins with you see the kick, you know, and then it goes to black and you don't see, you know, obviously he doesn't make it, but you don't see what happens. And at the end, he makes it and the Bills win the Super Bowl. I was a little bit against it. I don't love the ending. And I, you know, some people like it, some people don't. I feel like it's pretty polarizing. I feel like we spent the whole film saying like, it's okay that they didn't win. Why fake it at the end? Right. But on the other hand, how do you end it? So it's cool to see. I don't feel like Bills fans need to be, I guess, coddled in that way. Like, we want the real thing. I don't think anybody cares about, you know, seeing the fake Super Bowl win. I think all of us just want the real one, if that makes sense.
First thing that came to mind to me was the Sopranos ending. It's polarizing. There's a lot of people who hate it, a lot of people that love it. But the way you put it, Bills fans don't need to be coddled. Mm-hmm. And the fans of the Sopranos who watch Tony Soprano commit heinous crimes for 6 seasons didn't need to be coddled at the end of that show either. I think that's what makes a film great, when you're questioning whether or not the ending was great or you didn't like it, because that in itself is the goal, right? To keep you wondering what could have been, you know, what would it have been like? Because things right now in Buffalo, I can't even imagine how much different it would be if that kick was just 3 feet to the left. I can't imagine.
It changes everything.
And it's, in a selfish way, being my age, not living through that, I don't think I'd go back and change anything. I want to be around for that first win. And getting so close to it last year, that was my first real taste of what I always felt that my dad was able to experience in the late 90s. Because when I was born in 97, it was nothing but the drought up until Coach McDermott came in and got to the playoffs on the arm of Andy Dalton and Tyler Boyd. I mean, that was my, I cried like a newborn when that touchdown, you know, was scored and the Bills were off to the playoffs for the first time. So I can't imagine what that was like. And to now have a bit of that feel, this team, now, I didn't know the team from the 90s, but from the sentiment I get from the older fans, including my dad, and just, you know, looking at the fan base in a whole, especially because now you can interact with anybody on Twitter and whatnot. This new organization under Bean and McDermott, it seems like the closest thing we've had to that era. And I guess I'll ask you, you know, you went through and you made the film, you grew up through that era. Do you feel the same way, having watched this team over the last couple of years? Does it feel like it's trending more towards that direction? Does it feel like a similar feel?
Yeah, I mean, it's so hard to say, because when you're a kid, everything is different. So to compare it to an experience as an adult, I don't know. But yes, and I was thinking about that earlier too, when you were asking about my experience, you know, in the early 90s, like, it's closer than it's ever been since, right? And that's just obvious for, you know, from a wins losses standpoint, but you can feel how much the fans respect Bean and McDermott and love them and believe that this team is going to be good. So I would say you could feel the shift in Bills fans from feeling like losers to feeling like, you know, this city is, you know, on the rise, like this team is going to be good, and believing in it, not feeling like, oh, when's the other shoe going to drop? Like, you can feel that shift in the air, I think. And, you know, there were always Bills fans everywhere. You know, when you see a hat or a shirt out of town, there's always the Go Bills. That never changed, but now there's a little bit more pride with it, I think, or a little more feeling of, you know, not just, hey, you're from Buffalo, we both love Buffalo, but yeah, we're the good team now, which is cool to see that shift. Yeah. And to see little, you know, and especially with like the younger generation, there's a lot of kids who grew up, you know, Peyton Manning fans, because we didn't have a great quarterback during that era, or, you know, I won't mention the other great quarterback, but, you know, my nephew started out, you know, he had a Manning jersey. Then he was a Broncos fan when Manning was there. And now, you know, he's, you know, kind of coming back around toward the Bills again. He better be anyway. So it's cool to see that. Yeah.
I saw Eric Woods' kid begged him to wear the Josh Allen jersey in the school photo. That was not a conversation I was having with my parents when I was a kid, because I don't think there was a player on the Bills team who was as exciting as Josh Allen, of course, is as much of a superstar as Josh Allen is, of course. And he's just one of them. Of course, Josh is the main character. But with the cast of guys this Bills team has now, that, in addition to the culture, like you were just touching on, that's what makes me feel like this has to be similar to that late 90s team. You have so many stars. You have so many household names. And the culture, it seemed like it was there under Marv Levy. It is definitely here now with Coach McDermott. You feel that. Like you said, it's intangible. You can't see it, but you really do feel it. And when I've talked to players that I've had on here, they say that is the reality. You, what we feel, you know, watching them on TV, seeing how things go down, is exactly the sentiment within the locker room. And I was speaking to Ike Butker a couple weeks ago, and, you know, he said that he's talked to other players around the league, friends of his and whatnot, and based on what they've said, he flat out said it sounds miserable to be anywhere other than Buffalo. And I just think it's so cool that even though we think it's like that, it really is like that when you speak to these guys.
Yeah, I don't think Stefon Diggs would be blowing smoke if he didn't really love it here too, right? He doesn't seem like the kind of guy who is just going to fake it, right?
So, well, that's a great point, because everybody was kind of thinking he was going to be some diva, right, coming into Buffalo. He shut that narrative down almost immediately.
Yeah, exactly. It is. And it's such a great point that this is the destination now. This is the place you want to be, between the culture and the facilities, the fan base. Like, it's exciting for a guy to be drafted to Buffalo now, which is a very cool place to be. Like, we miss that. And like, when you think about, I was just thinking about, you know, the feeling in the community, all the Allen Diggs 2020 signs on the yards. And like I get a little tug at the heartstrings every time I see a group of kids playing football in their front yard and they're all in different Bills jerseys. And, you know, 10 years ago, that might not have been the case.
Right. And there's a couple examples to back all that up. I mean, I'll never forget when Cole Beasley, coming from Dallas, flat out said the Bills facilities are better than what they are in Jerry World, which really blew my mind. And then, you know, a couple months ago, Isaiah McKenzie said he'd come back and play for Candy if that's what Brandon Bean offered him in the contract negotiations. That's what's going on in Buffalo right now. And to say that to think that, you know, like you said, 10 years ago or whatever, this is a mindset that I wondered if I'd ever have. And now I wonder if it'll ever leave. That's how quickly it switched. And it's so, it embodies you very, very quickly. And it's a feeling you don't want to lose.
I know, exactly. And we were denied it for so long. I feel like nobody appreciates winning more than Bills fans in this league. Like,
oh, you know,
and I think we could never talk trash to anybody, you know, like when you were saying, like, would I take the Super Bowl or not? And that, you know, take that one Super Bowl, I would take the Super Bowl because then at least you have something. Like almost every other team, even Jets fans, had Super Bowl III. It's like, God, we just, you know, you need something to hold over people's heads. Now, if we had won the one Super Bowl and didn't go back, I wouldn't have had the 30 for 30. My whole career could be different, but gosh, just for the ability to like have something to back up your trash talk would have been nice.
100%. Let's step back into your career a bit, because it's a very intriguing road that you went down. If I'm not mistaken, your initial goal was to get into book publishing. Is that correct?
You did the deep dive on me, huh? Yeah.
I have to do my due diligence here. But I found it interesting because when I read that, I said, how do you go from going down that road to becoming what you've become within NFL Films and now at Pagula Entertainment? You kind of just sent your resume out on a whim. And did you ever think it would turn into what it has turned into today for you?
No, I mean, I had no idea. So I was living in New York. Yeah, just kind of looking. I was working at a private equity firm, just looking for a real job. I was hoping to get into publishing. Had an interview at Random House right before I interviewed at NFL Films. And I joined the New York City Bills backers. So Matt Cable, Matt Sirico, those guys, you know, I have them to thank really for like the turn in my career path, because I had so much fun with them. We had so much fun hanging out. I started writing like at the time we were calling it a column, it would be a blog in today's lingo. An online, just, you know, hey, here's a recap of what happened at the bar. And I would try to make it funny and quirky. And we eventually had Marv Levy come for a book signing. We were just emailing each other, AOL Instant Messenger chatting. This is the 2004 season, about, you know, what can we do at the bar and what's going on with the bills. And I was just having so much fun. I'm like, I want this to be my job. Like, how do I make this my job? And yeah, I had a coworker who had a former college roommate who worked at NFL Films and gave her my resume, had no idea what would happen. And it just turned out that they were, you know, they hired a group of people at that exact time. And I was the first hire in that group. So it was awesome. And they hired me because they had two reasons: my writing skills. So I was not a production major in college. I was a communications journalism major and an English major with a writing concentration. So they hired me because I was a writer, and they figured if you can write, you can tell a story. We can teach you how to do all the editing and the rest of it. And they hired me because I love the Bills and they could feel my passion for the team. And, you know, in their mind, if you're really connected to the team and love the game in that way and love the people of your city, then, you know, you're going to be able to tell good stories and connect with them. So that was my ticket in.
Run that clip back for anybody who says it's just a sport or, oh, you're just a fan, because look what you've become by simply being a passionate Bills fan. You have used that as the driving force behind an entire career. That is amazing.
And people will tell you, don't be a fan. If you're too much of a fan, no one will hire you. And that might be true if you're trying to become a journalist and you have to be objective about things. But for me, it was what got me in, was that they loved how much of a fan I was and appreciated that and knew that I would, you know, throw my heart and soul into it.
What was it like coming in to NFL Films without that film experience? You're obviously into the writing aspect of things. How daunting was that, your first, you know, go around as you entered NFL Films?
What's cool about being 23 is you never really understand how daunting something is. You're just like, well, I've been learning my whole life and I figured it out up till now, so why would this be any different, right? So it was nice because I got to come in with like a class of people. I think there were 9 of us at the time, and a couple of us were production assistants, PAs, who hadn't done this before. And, you know, we might have been at slightly different levels, but they taught us everything and we got to learn together as a group and figure it all out. And they, you know, they brought us along slowly. It was more daunting in the interview, where I sat in an office with 4 men who were interviewed, like, who had been working there for, at the time, it was at least 15 years, some of them even longer, and were grilling me about my football knowledge and, you know, my pop culture knowledge and everything, making sure that I would be a good fit. So that was more daunting. Once I was in, everybody was very welcoming, and it was so cool to learn from, you know, people who've been working there since the 70s or the late 60s and, you know, figure out how to tell stories, you know, with them or from them.
That's my kind of interview. Please fill us in on your football knowledge as best you can. Now that is the interview that I want to sit down and be a part of. So 10 years at NFL Films, a full decade. And I mean, the different opportunities you had there were great. The one that really stood out to me is a show that obviously most all NFL fans find themselves watching at some point throughout the year as it airs on HBO. You worked on Hard Knocks with the Cincinnati Bengals. Talk to me a little bit about that experience, because, you know, Hard Knocks is the one opportunity a year where fans really get to see how things go down off the field.
Yeah. So I worked on a couple seasons of Hard Knocks. The Bengals, I think, was the second time I actually went out on location. So I'd gone out, Dallas Cowboys, I think, were the year before, maybe. Mm-hmm. They do their training camp, or they did at the time, in Oxnard, California. So we went out there for that. And then 2009, went down to Kentucky for the Bengals training camp. So I was on location for that, which was awesome. The less awesome part, well, if you're a football nerd, this would be awesome to you, is I was sitting in the robotics trailer watching all the team meetings. That was my job, was to sit there. So the guys would come in after practice exhausted, and, you know, the tight ends room, the offensive line room, the linebackers room, the coaches meeting room. And I would sit there and watch and hit record when things got interesting, because, you know, there's 70-ish producers at NFL Films. Maybe 50 of them are working on Hard Knocks any given summer. At least that's how it was when I was there. And somebody's got to go through all the footage. So you roll on as much as you can. You definitely roll on way more than you could ever possibly need, but you don't want to roll on necessarily everything. So yeah, I would go through and take notes so that the producers knew, like, hey, this is really fun, this is interesting, this is good. And I would just hop in between meetings. I learned a lot more about football in those weeks than I ever knew before.
Right. What's the turnaround process like to get things out quickly from week to week so you can stay relevant based on the storylines?
Yeah. So at least when I was there, we were actually still FedExing tapes back to the office. So now I'm sure they're feeding everything back, which is a lot easier, which is what they do from games too. They can actually send the footage like after every quarter back to NFL Films so like people can start what we call special rolling it, basically logging it and going through it. So basically you kind of start shooting. Sometimes you do some like early summer shoots where you get the guys packing or like you're with visiting so-and-so in their hometown to like get to know the characters of the show. The first episode is usually from 2 weeks of shooting. And then after that, it's pretty much week to week turnaround. So you know, everything that's shot up until Monday would make the Tuesday show or whatever. So, or Wednesday show, whenever it airs. So it's basically, and then sometimes things would happen that morning that you actually have to get into this show, but typically, it's you're shooting, sending it back. Producers are starting to go through it, log it, edit it into sequences. Then they take all those individual sequences and go into the bunker, as they call it, put it all together to build it into one show. So as a producer or an editor, you might be assigned tight ends, as an example, is your story. So you're going through all the footage that's labeled from tight ends in practice, tight ends in meetings, tight ends off the field, and just building out little sequences. And obviously the big group is meeting every day talking about the different storylines and what makes sense. And then they take everything. And sometimes what you cut didn't even make it into the show that week, which would be hard because you're, working late nights and it's a grind. You're working 7 days a week on Hard Knocks, often there until midnight and waking up the next morning and doing it all over again. But it's very rewarding and it's a very cool show to be part of.
Bills Embedded is kind of like the Bills' own version of Hard Knocks social media style. It gives fans the opportunity to dive into what goes on at the facility, and you're a major part of that. Talk to me a little bit about that project. It's fairly new over the last few years. What went into the thought process behind that? And overall, I mean, is that one of your favorite things to work on, knowing that you're bringing a perspective to fans that they wouldn't have otherwise?
Oh yeah, love it. And it's for exactly that reason. I love being able to show fans like, here's what's happening with our team. You know, I get to be a part of it all the time. I want you guys to see, so that's very rewarding for me to be able to do, because I know how much people live and die by the Bills. Embedded came about because we weren't doing Hard Knocks a couple of summers ago. It was like Sean's second season, I believe, Coach McDermott's. And we were like, we can do that. It was a year that I think Cleveland was doing it. We're like, we can, there's no reason why we can't do our own and do it, I'm not going to say better, but, put our own spin on it and give fans exactly what they want. So, we started that season. We did four episodes on training camp, which was great. So we literally embedded, we were in every single team meeting. We were in every single coach's meeting at the end of the day. We had people mic'd up for every practice. We had kind of full access. If I wanted to be in a position room, we kind of rotated because our staff is not 70 producers like it is at NFL Films. There was just a couple of us going through everything. So we had to be a little bit more choosy about what we were filming, but Sean was very welcoming and we got a lot of cool access. And I think that show really is something that cemented Bills fans, trust and appreciation in Sean, because they really got to see how he operates. And so, that got picked up, ESPN was showing clips of it. And, obviously it went, a couple clips went viral on social media, the MC Hammer stuff. So it was very cool to get to have fans get to know Sean, the way that we kind of know him and see that he is the real deal.
Yeah, it's a really good point. I mean, you really get to feel like you know somebody without actually knowing them when you watch stuff like that. And as you watch the members of the Bills, it kind of just reiterates things you already thought. You know what I mean? It really kind of drives those points home. One of my favorites was the recap of the 21 season. I think it really told a great story of where the Bills have come to up until that point, having been through everything, of course, that the organization had been through for what felt like forever, to reach the pinnacle of getting to the AFC Championship a season ago. And that episode was, that was almost a half hour long. Was it special for you to really have an opportunity to encapsulate the season as well as everything that went into it years prior building up to that point?
Yeah. So actually that kind of came about by necessity, the way that we framed that episode. So you're talking about growth mindset, which ran on TV. And then we also had it on YouTube in early March, I believe it aired. So you should check that out if you haven't watched it yet. Yeah. But Yeah, so it was cool to do. And it, like you said, we kind of went back through the last 4 years and saw, like, how did we get to this point? So we went and used some old embedded footage and found scenes of, like, you know, Trey White meeting Coach McDermott for the first time, Josh seeing his parents on the field after his first win, like stuff that it's like very cool to go back and look at now that we've kind of, you know, gotten really good. But in my ideal world, that would have been a recap of all the behind the scenes of last season and seeing the team, you know, building itself through that season and how that progressed. But with COVID, we just couldn't do it. So it's a bittersweet thing. I love the way that it turned out and the way that we were able to make a cool show that spoke to fans, you know, without that access. But I wish that we'd had more access during this 1 year. It's like you're finally good. And all these things that you as a producer want to be able to do with the team. And we can't even get in the same room with players, let alone film anything. So that was, it was tough. It was a tough year to be good. On the other hand, you know, you almost felt like you were more of a fan living it, which is cool too on its own.
100%. And in the mindset that I had all throughout the past season is, man, would it have been unlike anything else to have been in that stadium throughout the year to have been a part of that. Obviously doing that year in and year out prior to that, you can't imagine what the atmosphere would have been like in a season like what last year's was. The atmosphere to begin with is already off the charts. Try turning that up to 11 and breaking the knob. But I never let that bother me because I couldn't imagine what the year would have been like during the pandemic had the Bills not have had that season. So I step back and look at it, like you said, from the fan perspective and think, yeah, it's unfortunate we weren't able to be a part of it. I'm sure for you, yeah, it's unfortunate we weren't able to do the things as a producer that we really would have loved to. But man, what a year to finally do the things we've all been waiting for when we have literally nothing else. The Bills were just the light at the end of the tunnel for months on end in a time where, you know, everybody was really going through it.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with that too. And I think a lot of fans felt that way. And we've definitely heard that, and the players would hear that from them. You know, it was that we can't go anywhere. We're stuck inside. Maybe you've lost someone or know someone who was sick during that time. And obviously football doesn't make everything better, but it gave you something to hold on to. And I think that meant a lot to everybody in this community. So agree. And it was something else that we all kind of collectively went through together, a shared experience for all of us that we couldn't be there for that. And like, now you have your own stories about the COVID season and right. How you watched games in your driveway, or, you know, you had your buddies on a Zoom call so you could still all watch together. And so it kind of created another shared experience that we'll all be talking about hopefully years from now.
And it'll make this coming season that much more special too. You'll remember the 2020 season for being the year during COVID, but you'll remember the 21 season for being the post-COVID year where we were all back. And, you know, it's little things that you don't think about. Like Stephon Diggs has not played in front of Bills Mafia yet. That is something that it's tough to think about. All of a sudden, Stephon Diggs, 1 year in, he feels like he's been a part of the Bills forever. He's never played in front of a full crowd, which is really insane to think about, but it's exciting to know that it's right around the corner. Now, were you at the Colts home playoff game, the first one, correct?
Yes, I was at both playoff games. Yeah.
You were.
Very, very lucky. I understand my privilege in that one. Yeah.
Well, listen, if there's one thing to brag about, it is 100% that. Let's talk about the first one. Were you working during it, or were you there just as a fan?
No, I got to take my dad to that game. So that was his first ever Bills playoff game. It was really mine too, you know, in person. It was a really special moment to be able to do that. And, you know, at the time I didn't know if I was going to get to go to the second one. So yeah, I couldn't work at it because only certain employees were even allowed in the stadium. And with what I do, like, there was nothing for me to do in the stadium basically because of all the protocols and everything.
Sure.
So yeah, so I was able to attend as a fan, which was awesome. It was a surreal experience in a way, like that, the final Hail Mary, you know, and it's funny because I was in the end zone where they threw the Hail Mary at, and it seemed to me that they were way closer than they actually were. When I went back and watched the highlights, I'm like, oh, they were almost to midfield when he chucked that thing. Like, to me, when they had that chance, like that he'd been, you know, the last two drives or whatever, like drove right down the field. So I was very nervous. So just that whole experience of, like, you know, typically for Bills, this doesn't go well for us. Is this really going to happen to us again? And then that euphoric moment of, no, like, they just won this game, and they did it with the play that had haunted them from earlier in the season. Like, are you kidding me? Like, this is incredible.
You know, it can beat them. We've seen it happen. You know. Yeah.
So the fact that they and then the fumble that was. You know, and thinking like, oh, are they really going to take this away from us? Like, that was a fumble. Like, this game should be over. So you've got that like bitterness in your heart, and you're thinking like, oh God, please don't let this affect how they're playing. You know, obviously they're professionals. They had it under control, but in your little fan heart, you're just dying inside thinking like, I can't believe this is going to happen to us again. So it was exercising a lot of demons that game. And plus being there with my dad, it was so special.
Obligatory question for everybody that was in the stadium for the Ravens game. Talk me through your personal experience being in the stands as Taron Johnson picks off Lamar Jackson and takes it to the house for what will always be remembered as one of the greatest plays in Bills history.
Yeah, I was again in the opposite end, or this time I was in the opposite of end zone from where it happened. So he ran toward us, although in the opposite corner for the touchdown portion of that. So it took a second to realize that he was the one with the ball, you know, because there was a bunch of Ravens right there. He sort of like came out of, you know, in my mind, out of nowhere, grabbed it. Exciting. And then you see him running and you realize, because you can see the whole field from your perspective in the stadium, you realize like he's probably going to go. It was like an out of body experience where like your whole life flashed before your eyes and you're just like, you know, your whole Bills fandom life, like he's running down. It could have been 10 minutes. He was running down the field and you're just thinking about all the things and like just so excited, jumping up and down, giddy of,
yeah,
this is really happening. This is crazy. I can't believe this. It just, the euphoria I can't describe. And I was there with my husband, my brother, and my cousin. And so, you know, my husband supports the Bills, you know, through marriage, basically. He didn't grow up a Bills fan, but my brother and my cousin, you know, we went through this together in the early 90s. Like, we've done this together our whole lives. And just the feeling of euphoria, I don't even know if I could explain it, how cool that was. It was just unbelievable.
I don't think you need to explain it. Your body language and the lack of being able to put it into words is 100% explaining it enough. I mean, it was just a play you'll never forget, right? And it was in a moment, kind of back to what you were alluding to just a minute ago, and something that obviously is on the mind of Bills fans at all times. You're waiting for that moment to happen that just seems inevitable at all times. When's it going to go wrong? The Ravens were driving. They're right there on the doorstep. And Taron Johnson pulls off a play that, for a lack of a better term, is just non-Billsian. It's not a Billsy play. It's not a... You don't see that happen in a big moment for the Bills over the years. And there it was in the biggest moment you could imagine. And to say I'm jealous of you being in that stadium for that is an understatement. It was incredible.
I'll never forget it. And we, you know, you're taking videos with your family and pictures of that moment. And like, we obviously, you know, I snapped a photo like right after it. And I'm like, I always want to remember where we were and how we felt. You know, when that happened, it was just unbelievable.
It's amazing you had the wherewithal to even think about that. I don't think
I never do.
Yeah.
I purposely, and then I started taking videos toward the end because I almost never take pictures. I'm that person who's always like, we didn't take a picture this whole time.
Right.
Yeah. It was that big of a moment where I'm like, I need to, even though my fingers are freezing, I need to take my phone out.
The producer mindset.
Exactly. Yes, it's true. It's so true.
Yes.
And I knew that we were actually, we mic'd up the chefs for that game, you know, the fans.
Yes, yes.
Yes, Norman Pooh. So we had them mic'd up and my coworker was down there filming. I couldn't be there because of all the protocols. You can only have one person, all that. So I was just so excited when that happened and thinking, oh my God, and it happened right in front of them. So they, you know, one of them ran down and you're like, you're not supposed to, ran down the stairs to like get closer to celebrate right behind the screen where Johnson and Micah Hyde were crashing into it. And, you know, it just, Bills wins are on multiple levels for me now because, you know, it's the excitement of being a fan. It's loving that, you know, the place where you work, things are happening, but knowing like if we have a good piece of video production coming out on it and knowing that the fans are going to be able to react to it is like, it's so exciting. It's so rewarding. And I'll give you another example of that. So the Denver game this past December, we had made that Steve Tasker, you know, Bills win the division for the first time in 25 years video, worked on it. We're like, you know, working on it, like through that morning, there was a few final tweaks and like trying to get everything ready and knowing we have to win that game for this video to run because we went for it in that video. We said, we're not backing in this year. like the Bills are a good team. Like we there's literally a line that says we're not backing in. We're not going to the playoffs on a guest pass. Like we're writing our own ticket. And I'm like, well, if we lose this game and then we end up going into the playoffs because say Miami loses Sunday, that's backing it. You know, it's like, yeah, you know, we won the division, we're going to the playoffs, but you want to win to get in there. I mean, we said we were going to do that. So I was sweating that game. Like there was so much on the line for me personally. I'm like, we got to get this video out. We have to win. And luckily, you know, during the game, it was very one-sided. So it wasn't too stressful, but I was so excited knowing, you know, when we were going to win that game, like this video is coming right out right after and the fans are going to lose their minds. I was so happy about that.
I was going to say, lucky for you, that game was over 5 minutes in. So
yeah, I know.
It wasn't much to stress about.
I still stood, I think, for the entire game. I was like leaning on my kitchen island. So,
And it encapsulated the message that video brought out, where it was not a fluke. The Bills just destroyed the Broncos. And that basically was the icing on the cake, seeing that later on in the day. It reiterated what we had just watched. Let's talk about that video. I mean, I don't know if you got one of your 13 Emmys for that, but I think a 14th should be on the way. It was that good. Did you know when the final edit was made, did you think to yourself, yeah, this is going to be massive within the Bills fan base?
Yeah. I mean, I think, I don't know if I knew how big it was going to be. I was excited for it. Just like with a lot of our videos, I think it surpassed my expectation with how excited people were. I mean, but it shouldn't have, because winning the division, like everything that happened this season, how good we were. I was hoping that people would respond to Steve in his, you know, jaunty little hat and scarf with a cigar, but you know, they did even more. The it might be chilly thing was the last line we added sort of as like what are we going to do here? Like it was like a second, an afterthought kind of thing that blew up way bigger than I was expecting. I was like, oh, I worked so hard at that script. The one line.
Yep. Isn't that always the way it goes? Yeah. The one throwaway thing is always the biggest, right?
Yeah. And I have to give credit to the editor. I was like, all right, so we need a line at the end where he should be like, we'll see you in Buffalo. It's something about how it's going to be cold. And he was like, might be chilly. And I was like, yeah, okay. And so he and Andrew Quinn gets credit for that line. But
I'm so glad that's how it came to life in that way, where it was just like, well, we need something, throw it in. Oh, it just wound up becoming the catchphrase of a lifetime for Bills fans. I mean,
it's all about how Steve delivered it, though. And then, you know, the wink at the end, like that. Oh, it was just like a combination of
cigar. The whole thing was it was a masterpiece. It truly was. So, you know, obviously that video, the embedded, a bunch of stuff going on day to day with you and the Bills and churning out content. I was telling you off air, I'm in a similar line of work as you, not nearly as cool of a subject matter. But the one thing as, you know, a producer is what most people don't think of when you're not a producer is when you're watching something, there's part of you where your brain kind of shuts off and you just somewhat think that the whatever you're watching just kind of fell out of the sky. You don't think about the fact that everything you're watching, every minute detail was handcrafted by an individual. And, you know, that of course is the magic within it, right? Let's talk about your job in itself and how these things come to life. What's a day-to-day work day like for Michelle and working, you know, for the Bills as a producer?
Yeah, I mean, it's different every day because I also work for the Sabres too. Right. So, and you know, obviously the last year has been crazy. So I'm in the office at 79 Perry now, but you know, yesterday I was working from home all during the football season. You know, I was working sometimes in the office, but never at the Bills facility because we couldn't be there. So a lot of times working from home. So it's different. So like today, you know, I'm doing a, you know, besides this very important piece of filmmaking here, I'm working on with one of my co-producers on a list of, you know, what are we going to do for Beyond Blue and Red next year? Like what stories are we going to try to hit with our players? So that series awesomely is going to be coming back next year, which was sort of on hiatus this year, although we did still do some documentary work with Josh Allen. If you remember, we did that piece on the Oshai donations and how great his season was. And then we did another kind of season recap piece just on the great season at the end of December. Yeah, so thinking about that, but also planning for draft lottery next week for the Sabres and bringing back Sabres Embedded. So, you know, what are we going to film for that? And then planning some shoots with Josh Allen for the offseason, which I'm so excited about because, you know, we haven't seen him in person in a year. Bills fans haven't had that, Like, you know, you grow accustomed to these documentaries that we put out, whether it's embedded or even just a little social video of here's Josh Allen goofing around doing whatever. We haven't had that access. So we've got a couple shoots with him coming up, planning an interview with Sean McDermott, you know, before everybody breaks for the summer. So lots of stuff in the works. You know, I do not only our documentary work, but we're doing, we have a huge fundraising campaign, Give 716, this year on 716 Day, where we're trying to raise a lot of money for local charities and organizations. So I'm working on like promotional videos for that. And so I'm like kind of all over the place, you know, marketing videos and just every little thing. I'm working on a video, I should say an editor is working on a video for me about Buffalo itself that we can put on our jobs page. Like I'm just kind of, I'm all over the map, but you know, my favorite days are, you know, like the draft a couple of weeks ago. And especially cause we got to be back in the building again. I had not set foot inside One Bills Drive in, you know, 15 months at that point. So we were there, you know, walking past, you know, Brandon Bean and Sean McDermott saying hi again, which had been so long. Like I texted my husband while I was there. I'm like, it feels so good to be here and like feel part of the team again and be back, you know, among the excitement. And I think that they kind of felt that too. You know, they were able to draft without masks on in the room. They couldn't have everybody in that, you know, they would have wanted to in a normal year, but it just kind of felt like things are moving in the right direction. So yeah, those are the best days when you're able to shoot things. And, you know, we had Greg Rousseau come in the day after he was drafted and got to follow him around the building and interview him. And so, yeah, those are the best days for sure.
Saw that. That was a great piece. Do you ever get used to seeing how massive these guys truly are in person? Or is that something you're not used to?
You get used to it because I didn't even realize how big he was. So I saw the photo like everybody else. Like they're all big to me. So like once you're over 6'5", I'm sort of like, you know, I'm 5'6". So they all tower over me. But yeah, I think you do. I will say the first time I was ever on around football players like this in person was the first Sunday night football game of the 2005 season. We were in the Ravens stadium. It was a Colts Ravens game. And I was on the sideline for the first time. And seeing these guys in full pads with their cleats on, like the punter was huge. The kicker was huge. Like that was my first moment of being like, holy cow, these are huge people. And now, yeah, I think you definitely do get used to it.
That picture of Rousseau with McDermott and Bean is amazing. Are you taller than Matty Glab? Because I saw
everybody's taller than Matty Glab.
Well, I saw the picture of who was it with? It was either with
Doyle or
to say Tommy Doyle. Where I mean, it literally looks like he is four times the size of her in this photo. It looks like he could pick her up and throw her like a football.
Yeah. And that's like that perspective thing too, where like the Rousseau photo is so exaggerated just based on the angle of it. So he's like slightly closer to the camera, which gives you that feeling of that he's like, you know, 8 feet tall instead of 6'7" or whatever. But yeah. And so Maddie's closer to the camera in that image and she looks even smaller somehow. So yeah, she's like 5 feet tall. So I would say she's probably the shortest in the department.
How soon are you getting back with Josh Allen? And do you want to see him rock the visor this year? Because that's the big talk amongst fans this week.
So the visor seems to be a practice only thing. I don't think that's happening during a game. I am not as attached to the uniform choices as many fans are, like the white face mask thing. I appreciate that fans are very passionate about it. I'm all for it. If they are, to me, it doesn't make that much of a difference. Is that terrible to say? Like, I am not.
Speaking of which, though, were you in on the reveal video? Was that you?
I did not produce it. So we had two guys who are awesome, who do all of our TikToks that you've probably seen.
Yeah.
Kevin and James, they produce that video. However, I was in on it literally because my daughter is the one who picks up the helmet in the playground at the beginning. And then I'm the one pulling her away.
Yeah.
So I was literally in it and did not produce it, though they get all credit for the creative vision behind it.
That video threw a lot of fans for a loop because there's a lot of people, including Ike Butker, ironically enough, which I thought was hilarious when I talked to him. He was like, I didn't know if it was real or not because it was April Fool's Day. I'm like, dude, no, nobody did. Everybody thought it was a joke. It wound up being real. Everybody was stoked about it.
Yeah, it was. You kind of had to see because we did two videos. So you had to see both of them in succession to really get the joke. If you just saw the first one or the second one, you were totally confused.
Yes.
So that's what April Fool's Day is for, right? But yeah, no, it is real. It's actually happening. So you will see your white face mask next season. But yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter to me. I think the visor looks cool. If it's going to help him win games, wear it. If it doesn't matter. Although I will say the uniforms now are so, so, so much better than they were 10, 12 years ago.
I don't know who
those were hideous. Even I could pick up on that. Yeah.
I don't know who was, I don't know what was going on in that round table with the Navy blue, but when they decided to come back with it, it's top tier. The all blue, the all white. I'm one of those lunatics though, that was all in on the white face mask though. Sorry. Yeah. I was beyond excited because the reason I'm like that, I always go back to the one game that made me truly realize, why do they not just do this permanently? It was Thanksgiving Day against the Dallas Cowboys, the all blues with the white face mask. And it was just like, man, they just look so good. There's no way they can't play good. And it finally trickled in, I think, to the mindset of everybody, including the team. And now it's here. So one more thing to be excited about, not that we're already, you know, stoked enough getting back into the stadium. We get to see those white face masks. And I guess when you see Josh next, I don't know, maybe give him a tip that the rest of the fan base would love to see at least one game where he's out on the field with that thing. Because I know, like what you said, it's a practice only thing. He told the boys from Barstool that he wears it in practice essentially to make things tougher. If that's not the most Josh Allen thing ever, I don't know what is. But all I know is everybody loved seeing him in that visor.
It looks great. You can't deny it.
Definitely cannot deny it.
I'll mention it to him should I see him again in the next few weeks.
Well, Michelle, I know that you are as busy as it gets, and I appreciate you carving out an hour here to spend time with me. And like I said prior, this was the interview that I was looking forward to the most out of all I've done, and it lived up to the hype. You were so great in picking your brain about all the things that we see as fans that, you know, people don't really know all the time what all goes into that and who the faces are that put that stuff out for us to enjoy. That this was truly, truly amazing, and your story is incredible. And on behalf of the entire fan base, we can't thank you enough for all the stuff that you guys put out and you know, delivering stuff to us constantly to enjoy, because we definitely cannot get enough of it. There's one thing about Bills Mafia, they cannot get enough Bills anything. If it's Bills, they're consuming it.
Can I pick your brain on something? Do we have a minute, or we got to wrap it up?
Absolutely. I got plenty.
I'm going to ask you. All right. What was your favorite scene in Embedded from this last draft Embedded? Like what stood out to you? Maybe not, you know, just like a little moment maybe. Cause I'm always curious, you know, I'm making these and like there's certain things where I'm like, oh, this absolutely has to be in there. This detail. And I'm always curious, like if the fans pick up on it, or if you see the same things I do as like, this is cool.
I liked how you incorporated Rousseau in the gym working out. I thought that really demonstrated the type of freak athlete the Bills are bringing in to the locker room, because a lot of people were looking at Rousseau as a guy that had a similar storyline coming into the team that Josh Allen did, where you know he's a freak athlete. The ceiling is immeasurable. It's just a matter of, is he going to be able to hit that ceiling and when? But when you're trying to envision what he can become, the thing that comes to mind first is his size and his pure athleticism that is just visible. And when you incorporated the footage of him in the gym, he's got the cutoff on, and you're getting to know him as you're also watching him do inhuman type things that everybody watching it cannot do. I love stuff like that. Like there's been videos all throughout the off season here from other teams that I've seen where these guys are working out. And I really think that it shows you firsthand what goes into becoming that caliber of an athlete. I can't get enough of seeing that. And so when you do see it, and when you do see the new guy coming in, who looks the way Greg Rousseau does, it gets you very excited to know that guy's on your team and not on the other side of the line.
I always find that fascinating, because workout videos really do so well, whatever it is. If you just got a guy at the bench and you put a clip on social media, fans love it. The weight room stuff. And that's the stuff that can be hard to get, you know, past NFL coaches or trainers or whatever. I'm like, but you don't like the bang for your buck on getting a great shot of a guy working out.
Yeah.
People really do love it.
Well, I know just last week, Devin Singletary posted that photo of him shirtless. And it's like, is he eating 40 egg omelets a day? He looks double the size. He's huge. And everybody, now all of a sudden, everybody's like, oh, yeah, can't wait to see what Singletary's got this year. Because I think why people love it so much is that you kind of create your own story of what you think that's going to mean, what that workout is going to translate into, or what that additional size is going to mean on the field. I think it curries up a lot of it's like hopefulness that is going to translate into a better product on the field.
Yeah. It's like a little tease too. Yeah. Like, look how big he is. Like, I can't wait to see him in pads. I can't wait to see him, you know, out there doing his thing.
Exactly.
Anything to keep you engaged in the off season, right?
Oh, 100%. It doesn't take much, believe me. So if you keep putting it out, I will watch it. I promise. Before I let you go, is there anything coming up rather soon here that you are working on that will be released in the near future? Is everything just kind of tentative at this point?
Yeah. So like I said, we're going to be starting Beyond Blue and Red again. We probably won't release those. Everything's a little bit fluid right now based on, you know, access. We're still kind of waiting to hear about training camp protocols from the NFL. We don't 100% know what we'll be able to do, but we will be releasing those, you know, next season, which is great. We love telling those like kind of more personal stories, off the field stories about our players. Embedded. I can't tell you when that's coming back right now. Like I said, we're kind of waiting to hear what we're going to be able to get into and what we can shoot, but we will have some cool stuff specifically with Josh Allen coming your way. Some of those more candid, like real person moments rather than just the highlights, which will be very cool to get. I'm really excited just to be able to help fans get to know him again. You know, reacquaint them, if you will, with his personality and like that other side of him. To go along with the amazing highlights that he gave us last year. So those will be coming up. And then on Sabres side, yeah, we'll be rolling out Sabres Embedded again after the draft. So excited to work on that as well.
And I am excited to be reacquainted with those videos. I cannot wait, Michelle. Thank you so much for hopping on. You're welcome anytime. I'd love to do it again. Until then, I look forward to the new stuff you have coming out, a fresh new season coming where you're finally able to be back in the building and churning out the stuff that we all love. So we're all excited for it. I know I am. And can't wait to see what you have cooking up here in the 21 season. So, Michelle, thank you so much. And look forward to talking again soon.
Thanks for having me. Yeah.